Okay, so where I wanted to start was I wanted to learn more about your work as a doula. And like, yeah. I know a lot of people don't even know what that is. So yeah. If you wanted to like tell people what that is.
Definitely. I'm really passionate about it. So if I start rambling, just let me know.
Ramble. Get your life.
Yeah. So a doula is somebody who advocates for a birthing person. I like saying birthing person because, you know, there's all kinds of people that give birth,
right?
You know, and so I advocate for the birthing person. And we're not medically trained, so, you know, midwives, people get midwives and doulas mixed up. Midwives have, like, gone to school and, like, done training and done schooling to be certified midwives to work in hospitals or do home births. And yeah, that's a whole other thing, so I'm not gonna really talk about midwives. And doulas, we do all the like emotional stuff and try to get people prepared for birth before, during, and after. So there's prenatal doulas, there's labor doulas, and there's postpartum doulas.
Okay.
And so what that means, what it'll look like is, you know, I would come to somebody's home, kind of like if they're going to do a home birth, I kind of get to know the way around their home, like where the water is, where the food is, like if they have other kids, meet their family. It's going to be a part of it, but mainly talk about what their birth plan, pretty much, like what they want their birth to look like. And it's funny because birth plan is like kind of a fun thing. It's like birth is so predictable,
right?
But it's kind of nice to know like what you want. Like, do you want medication? Do you not want medication? What kind of medication do you not want? You know, a lot of people, you know, I'm there to like make most time I'm there to like for people that don't want an epidural.
Okay,
that's the big thing. Okay. It's the epidural. Because a lot of times people want to be...
If I had a kid, I would not want one.
Yeah.
Do not put that needle in my fucking back.
Mm-hmm. People want to be aware. They want to be conscious of what's happening. And a lot of times, epidural kind of, like, removes you from that experience.
Mm-hmm.
It creates this, like, it can create a little bit of, like, a disconnect, you know. And it can be traumatic, and all that affects the baby and what happens postpartum.
I know that like a lot of people have been talking, there's been like a lot of talk about like Black people especially, like Black women especially, sort of like moving like sort of back in the direction of like using doulas and like using midwives and like more I don't know what you would call it, I'm not an expert, like holistic approach like home births and just like more, I've seen a lot of people referring to it almost as like a getting back to our roots type of thing. How do you feel about that, especially like as a Black doula? Have you had people like talk to you about that, or like, I'm curious?
Yeah So I did my training. It was people of color only training for a reason, you know, like we could talk about our fears and my fears and our hesitations about giving birth in the hospital, because we have this long history of like Black people not being treated the best. With the whole book,
right?
You know, medical apartheid,
right? And the whole thing about like that. Black people don't feel pain, as much pain, and like not getting the right medication.
And I think it's stemming from this whole climate, and like Black people have never really trusted the doctors, right? Like we're the my mom comes from the old school, so she's just like growing up, like I wasn't even allowed to have like NyQuil, you know,
just
like,
on it.
Yeah, like oh, you sick, like just go sleep, I'll make you some soup, you know, like we don't really do medicine. My dad, I have to call my dad, be like, I'm dying to like get medicine, you know. So, and I think this is the political climate now is like, you know, people are just, you know, not trusting, you know, the government and the, all that just affects the hospitals, I feel like. And the drugs that they're giving out now, this is like making people addicted. And people just aren't trusting. And I think there is like this whole movement of being, you know, more natural. And there's a very like, and midwives, doulas, it's funny that there's like people are making professions and careers out of it. And even me calling myself a doula is like a funny thing, because like these are just people that should be your friends and your family that are coming to you and helping you out. You know, that's what it
was. I don't know. I don't know. Yeah, like I'm.
That's what it originally was. It was just like, oh, you know, like Cheryl down the street just had a baby last year. Like she can help you, and like, or like your sister, your younger sister, your mom, or your aunt, or something. It's just not like birth has been so removed from our society that we don't even think that way anymore.
What do you think about that? Like that disconnect. What is that about? I'm gonna like pepper you with fucking questions.
There's like a whole bunch of YouTube videos you can watch and like stuff on the internet you can watch, but I think it just comes from this like birth being so institutionalized is the thing, because it started from something, you know, like the original midwives, like the granny midwives and stuff, were black, and they were like helping all like the slaves on the plantations give birth. You know, there's usually one, like, and sometimes like the plantation owners, like children too, they were like, you know, the, and then white doctors were just like, you guys don't know what you're doing anymore, you guys are dirty and filthy, like you guys aren't doing a good job, like we got this from here. And you know, late 1800s, you know, they started having births inside hospitals.
Right.
And I think that's where a lot of the misinformation comes from about like birth being dangerous.
Right.
Because these white male doctors were like, had no idea what birth was. It was like, birth was like very like removed from like male society too.
Right.
Because it was like a female thing. It was like whatever. So they had no idea what they were doing. So they were like, work on cadavers and then go back, not wash their hands, because they didn't know about germs and stuff in like mid, like 1800s. Not wash your hands and stuff, and then like work with giving birth, and women would get really sick and like have fevers and die.
Right.
So I think that's part of where the myth comes from about birth.
Ah, white people ruining things as always.
Where do I go from there? So it was just like, clearly you just took the job away from like black women.
I also know, like I've read that people like pick, a lot of people pick up infections in hospitals all the time. And like that happened to my cousin. Like she went to give birth in a hospital, and I can't think of exactly what the term for it is, but I know that there's a name for it, like an infection that you pick up in the hospital. And she ended up getting
MRSA.
She got like bacteria. She had like a C-section. They like cut
MRSA
her open.
Probably.
You would know.
Yeah. Bunch of the hospital.
She had like a bag, like a drainage bag that had to like drain. She ended up suing the hospital like successfully. And I was just like, I'm not with these hospitals. Like I don't like the doctor, I'm sure.
Yeah.
You know, that part of that is like the intergenerational trauma of, you know, not trusting doctors, the fact that
we have stories old and new. We have the Henrietta Lacks,
right?
They did not believe her. Like this person that has been inside her body and like probably is more in tune with her body than like anybody we know.
I mean, hopefully she is.
Yeah, but she's like a, you know, she's an athlete. I'm sure she like knows when her body is like not doing well.
Mm-hmm.
And they like didn't believe. Like she had to like beg,
right?
You know, like something's wrong with me, I need like somebody to like, you know, come check me out. Like she had to like beg them to do that.
I know that even like J. Marion Sims, who they call like the father of modern gynecology, he invented like the duck-billed like speculum. He was like a slave owner, and the way that he even like founded, I don't know if that's the right word, or you know, created so many of these like instruments and stuff was by like experimenting on like black women, like slave women, cutting them open with no anesthesia and like poking around and like seeing what's going on. And I know that there's a lot of like pushback against it. They have like a statue of him in like Central Park, and
oh yeah,
all these people talk about
the one where the women like lined up and they have
And they're like, you know, oh, he saved so many lives. And I've seen people get into like arguments about this, of people being like, well, you know, well, his modern techniques of gynecology have like saved so many women's lives, and it like paved the way for like pap smears and like knowing about cervical cancer. And it's like, yeah, but the way that he had to like experiment on black women and like cut black women open and like do all these horrible things. Mm-hmm. And even still to this day, like what you were just saying, like you still have all of this like medical racism of people like not believing that black people and that black women feel pain, and like all this stuff about like not wanting to prescribe like the right medication or overly medicating. So even this idea of like, well, it's fine that all these black women were tortured because we ended up with modern day gynecology, and it's almost like, well, even is modern day gynecology even like helping us as black women?
Yeah.
Or is modern day medicine helping black people? It's sort of like an interesting thing to kind of get into and think about, you know? I just don't know. Like, I don't know how I feel about this idea that like it's fucking fine to torment and literally torture black people. When people say that, this is what I hear.
Right.
He tortured black women so that white women could get pap smears and know about cervical cancer. So it's fine.
Right.
And I just feel like...
Totally.
That's kind of fucked up. Like, it's fucked up a little bit. I don't know. Maybe that's me.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm not with it.
I think... Yeah, and, you know, and there's still side effects of that stuff going on, you know? Like... So, America has, like... As far as developed, apparently we're overdeveloped, wealthy, among wealthy countries like Japan and Sweden and all these other places, like we have the highest infant mortality rate.
Mm-hmm.
So like...
Among developed countries.
Yeah, but only because they include non-white women in it. If you compare white women to those other countries,
mm-hmm.
It's fine. But as soon as we put our statistics in, it lowers significantly.
I didn't know that. Mm-hmm. Also, like, the white babies are fine and healthy, and the rest of us are fucking fucked.
Pretty much.
Right, that's what I'm saying. It's like, we're not even reaping the... It's really, like, on some... We're gonna, like, sacrifice...
Like, white women, like, go through it, too. Like, have, like, a lot of stuff around, like, this... birth and, you know, trauma around birth too, but it's like it's definitely more significant. And like, I forgot the statistics, but it was like 4 to 1, like four, like,
wow.
Like more,
I believe it.
More black women like than white women would have like horrible like birth experiences, pretty much.
I believe it.
Yeah. And so that's what kind of, like, I work with kids and stuff. That's kind of what like got me into it. It's like learning all this.
Yeah, how did you become
like my personal stuff? And I was kind of like also just kind of like trying to figure out what I want to do with my life. But it really just came from like me being like, this is information I need to know.
Right.
And like, there's a person I know right here in Oakland that's like doing like a people of color only. I was like the universe was just kind of like the stone in my face. I was like, okay, I need to learn this for some reason. And yeah, I'm just kind of like spreading the word ever since, like, to people, like, if you get pregnant and you're like a person of color, specifically a black person, like, you gotta go in there knowing your shit.
Yeah.
And you cannot go in there like, oh, I'm gonna let the doctor do whatever you want, because the doctor's gonna do whatever they want.
Right.
You know, you gotta be like, you know, if you don't
have kids, you're scaring me.
Yeah. I don't want to scare people, but it is like something you gotta be concerned about.
Right.
Like, you know, like, do you want an epidural? Like, if you don't want epidural, like, go in there and be like, I don't want epidural. Like, don't even ask me.
Right.
Stop asking, because they'll ask you, like, do you want pain meds?
And they
meds?
Push it on you.
Yeah, and they rush it too. They, like, it's a factory. They want you in and out. You know, they don't want you in there for 4 days, because birth can take 4 days, believe it or not. Mm-hmm. And, like, they don't want you in there for 4 days. Like, they, because you're, that's a bed space that they, for somebody else.
Right.
You know, like, you're taking a space. So, you know, if we can, like, if you're low risk, you know, some people have diabetes and things like that that make you high risk. But if you're like a low risk, especially if you're young and you're like a low risk birthing person,
they want labor at
home.
Labor at home.
Labor at home? Labor at home.
How does that work? I've always wondered.
So labor takes hours. You know, your first birth, most of the time, is going to take what I've seen on average takes like a good 24 to 48 hours. Mm-hmm. So if you just sleep at home, so, you know, it doesn't happen right away. People are like, you know, in the movies, it's like, my water break, you gotta go. Right. It's just like, okay. It doesn't work that way. So water breaking is like a slow process, mm-hmm. you know? It's not like, some people have a gush, but that's always being rejuvenated because amniotic fluid, that's what it is. Mm-hmm. It's just baby's pee. So as long as you're drinking, water, like that's always going to be replenished. Uh-huh. There's no such thing as a dry burn. Like, that's always going to be replenished. And it's usually like a slow trickle, mm-hmm. you know? Like it might be a gush at first, but then it's just like you know how it is when you're right here, it's like a trickle. Mm-hmm. Of, you know, keep doing that. You just like put a pad and like don't put any fingers up there or anything like that. Again, I'm not medically trained. This is just a reminder, but this is just like common knowledge that people should know.
It's not, I say it's not. I didn't know. You're informing me.
Yeah, yeah. And so,
how many births have you assisted in? Do you know? Do you
so
think that?
Yeah, I do know.
No?
No. On my own, clients that I've met have been like friends and family mm-hmm. so far. And so that's like, you know, like a, maybe like a under 10 people, but at the hospital, I volunteer at a hospital. Mm-hmm. So I just go in and just like meet people and like talk to all different types of people. So it had to be like over a dozen now.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, yes,
not all the, yeah, sometimes not all the way because I like, you know, I get tired, so I go home.
But. So I would say, so I have a question, another question, so many questions. So for Black women, how do you feel about, like, what direction would you, like, just you personally, just like your personal opinion, what direction do you feel like you would like to maybe see, like, Black women, like, go in terms of health and health about, like, reproductive health and childbirth? But, I mean, you don't have to stick strictly to that if you don't want. Just, like, health in general, what do you think would be, like, best? I mean, if you want to expand that to, like, Black people, it doesn't have to be women. Just, like, how do you feel? Like, what do you think would be best, like, for us moving forward in terms of like our health and like medicine and stuff like that?
Yeah.
Just I'm real like fuck these doctors, but yeah. What do you think?
Inform, you know, get your books, read your books. Just get informed. There's so much information out there. You know, there's a website called what's it called? Evidence-Based Birth. And it kind of like dispels all these myths about birth that we have.
Like what? What is a birth myth?
Oh, like baby making hips. There's no such thing as baby making hips. People like think that because they're small, uh-huh. like their pelvic girdle isn't gonna open up really well. Like all of that takes time and preparation, and just like knowing, getting in tune with your body. Like it's very, very like a spiritual thing, and like knowing what your triggers are. Mm-hmm. So when you go and just like, you know, if you have a hospital home birth, but then you end up going to hospital, like you know what your triggers are. Mm-hmm. Like if you've had trauma around that area, like most of us have, like knowing what your triggers are, so like your body has no problems opening up. Because mm-hmm. a lot of times you go in these situations and you just like tense up and that closes everything. Mm-hmm. And it just, in your, we're animals, you know, at the end of the day. So we get into our fight or flight mode, and if mom or a person is like trying to have a baby, there's like things that are triggering them and preventing that to happen. It's not gonna happen. It's gonna end up being a cesarean section. Mm-hmm. So
why do doctors push for C-sections? For money?
More money. The procedure costs more. The medication, there's more medication gotta be put under.
Capitalism is the devil.
It's faster. It's faster. The main thing is faster. You can schedule it. Uh-huh. You know, you can schedule around their time. Mm-hmm. You can clock in at 9 o'clock and leave by 5. Mm-hmm.
Because that happened to my friend. Like, I had a friend that got pregnant, and she really wanted to have a She wanted to have a natural birth or a vaginal birth. I don't know however you call it. And the doctors like pushed and pushed and pushed and pushed and pushed for a C-section. And she was like, no, 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 I don't want a C-section. I don't want a C-section. She was like literally like crying. Like they were trying to get her to sign the papers. She was like, no, I don't want a C-section. But then it ended up that she had to get the C-section because she had had fibroids previously, and so they were like, well, you can't push the baby out, and so you just like, we have to do it. So like, for your health and the health of the baby. So she ended up signing the form and they did it, but she was like very, she was upset, and she sort of even felt violated because she was like that all the times that she was meeting with her doctor, you know, prior, because you have to fucking meet your doc up with your doctor like a million times in your, over the course of your pregnancy, and she was like, the doctor kept saying it was fine, it was fine, it was fine, it was fine, she'd be able to like have the vaginal birth, like the fibroid shouldn't affect it, and it was fine. And then she said that, but her regular doctor was like not the doctor that delivered her, and it was almost like the doctor that delivered her like low-key like blindsided her.
In the hospital, so you think you're gonna have one midwife or whatever,
right?
But that midwife ends up having another birth, so you don't even have that person you've been working with,
right?
But I advocate people to get like midwives and doulas if you're low risk, or even if you are high risk, get a doula. You still have a doula with you at the hospital that advocate for you.
Oh, really?
What your needs are. Yeah, I work in a hospital, like I can advocate for people, like, you know, I can't tell like doctor what to do, but I can be like, you know, if the doctor says some really complicated stuff, like I have the knowledge to be like, you know, and like the brain capacity, because you're like in total like baby mode,
right?
You're like giving birth, and like the brain capacity to be like, is this what you like? I don't know if she wants that. Let me ask her when she's not having a contraction.
Right.
Like, let me ask her like what's going on, or ask them like what's going on. Like, do you want to do this? Like, does that sound good to you? And then I ask them a couple times. You know, like I'm not gonna. Like, they say yeah. Like, okay, yeah, let's do it.
Let's
like,
do it.
Like,
right.
You know, slow down, wait a second.
Who breaks?
Yeah. So that's what I want to see. Just like, so know your stuff, know your body.
After this, I'm gonna like go buy some books, cause
yeah, I got some good suggestions.
Yeah, this is like intense.
What? I think the main thing people should get is taking charge of your fertility. I think everybody should read that.
That's a book. Taking charge of your fertility.
Taking charge of your fertility. I feel like people should start there. It goes. It's really about you know, like kind of centers around birth control. It does everything, but the first half is about birth control and how to do like non-hormonal birth control.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't work for everybody, but if you have a regular cycle, like it could be pretty good. That's what I use, as well as like condoms. I think those are like pretty much like,
I know that covers everything. I don't like hormonal birth control.
Yeah,
and I know a lot of people don't.
I hate it.
You're putting extra hormones in your body. It's making you all like, it makes me feel like crazy. I don't like being crazy, but it makes me feel like
it does
loopy as hell.
Yeah. And then I had the idea that I was gonna make it better, and I'm like, and then like something in me was just like, my brain was just like, take it out. Like, it was like weird. Like, I would not think about it, and then like all of a sudden, like, I just like, yeah, it's just birth control is weird, and the concept of an IUD is weird too. Like, I'm gonna stick this
thing in your uterus,
right? In your cervix, which is like,
and you can leave it. They have ones you can leave in there for like years.
10 years.
Yeah, see, that's a lot. I don't know.
It's copper, and people have like reaction to the copper sometimes. Uh-huh. Like, a lot of people who've had reactions to it, like rashes, like they don't know where it came from, and it's just, it's foreign objects in your body, man. Like,
yeah.
I'm not religious, but if like God didn't put it there, then it's not supposed to be there. Like, I'm not religious at all, but like, I just feel like,
just like, not
even God, but like life in general, like,
right.
You know,
it's sort of an interesting concept.
And we were just like always told that like, you're fertile all the time, like don't have sex, like you're fertile all the time. And it's like, we're only fertile like 8 days.
I mean, you really learn a lot. I mean, some people do maybe, but like reproductive, what is it? Classes, like the stuff that they teach you in school, you kind of barely even learn anything about like reproduction. I mean, and I know in some places, like the only reproduction classes and shit is like bitch abstinence, like that's it. So it is kind of like you end up with a lot of people as adults that and especially Black people, but, you know, for various, you know, reasons in terms of medical racism and also, like, racism in the school systems and stuff like that, that are adults that don't know anything. Like, we don't know anything about our own bodies. We don't know about reproduction. We don't know about our rights, like you were saying, like, not knowing what our rights are, not knowing, like, what our fucking health is. And just, and then, like, you go and you're, like, seeing the doctors and the doctors just telling you all this stuff.
Yeah.
And then you, like, find out later on, like, oh, fucking institutionalized racism. Like, you might just be telling me a whole bunch of nonsense because you're a fucking racist. Like, it can be very scary, like, a very scary thing to, like, navigate the hospital system. I'm horrible. I never go to the doctor. I couldn't even tell you when was the last time I went to the doctor because I don't like going, and
yeah.
I don't really feel safe, and I don't really fucking even feel like they'd be knowing what they're talking about anyway. Like,
yeah, because they're working inside a certain
capitalism.
They're working inside the system where, like, you know, there's so many, like, protocols that they have to follow. The problem is, if we like to call it that, it's more like, it's not patient-based practicing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's staff-based practices, or, like, staff is just trying to cover their ass. They're trying not to get sued.
Right.
So if cesarean section is a faster, safer way to go, they're going
to
do it.
Yeah, and to sell you something, right? Mm-hmm. The medication and stuff.
Yeah, you know what's really fucked up?
You going to scare me? Oh, God, okay.
They don't allow you to eat when you're in birth. Birth is hard labor for hours.
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine working out for hours and then, like,
why are you not allowed to eat?
So they can give you a cesarean section.
Oh, that's like
so
I thought you were going to say, like,
no, that's
so you don't poop or something.
No.
But I know pooping happens.
Nobody cares about poop. I see poop all the time. I don't care about poop. I'm trying to get that baby out. I don't care about your poop. I don't care when you pee. Like, I literally, you can poop on me. I literally.
You can pee on you?
No. I wouldn't care, you know. I'm trying to, like, my main concern is delivering a healthy baby.
Right, as it should be.
Yeah,
as it should
I can
be.
Change my clothes, you
right.
know, like, I
can't change
care.
Out the baby.
Yeah,
no do-overs.
Yeah,
right.
So, but yeah, they're just, like, prepping you for cesarean. Like, you know, because your surgery, you can't eat before surgery.
Mm-hmm.
If you ever got surgery, you can't eat before.
No, I've never gotten surgery.
Yeah, so you
I
can't
am
eat
not
before.
Into the doctor. Like,
yeah.
Luckily, I've never needed surgery. I've never broken a bone or anything like that. But, like, I have had, like, some pretty nasty falls that have hurt,
yeah.
or had, like, bruises, or, you know, had, like, weird things happen. And most of the time, what I just say is, I just be like, if it still hurts in 7 days, I'll consider going to the doctor. Or if, like, if I'm still sick in, like,
yeah.
7 days, maybe. But, like, it's never lasted that long. Most of it has just gone away. So for all I know, I might have had, like, fractured toes and whatever, and I just, like, didn't want to go. I really have an aversion. Like, I really have an aversion
a
to
lot
the doctor.
Of us do.
I really don't like going
too.
To the doctor. I don't like going to the dentist either. I do just not. And again, like, I know people have talked about, and I personally believe in, like, intergenerational trauma, and, like, we've talked about it a little bit even on the channel. Like, I don't like dogs. Like, I have an aversion to dogs, and a lot of people, we've talked about how, like, a lot of Black people don't like dogs.
Mm-hmm.
And how that could be related to intergenerational trauma in terms of, like, slave catchers and dogs. You know, there's, like, a stereotype about Black people not wanting to swim, you know, not like in water, and a lot of people have said that's, like, intergenerational trauma from, you know, the Middle Passage and the slave ships and stuff. And I do believe
not like water. He's like, water was that. I'm like, let's go swimming in the lake. And she's
like,
what?
I like water. I like water. I enjoy swimming and stuff like that. But I know some people that have been, like, not even just that they just don't like water or that they don't know how to swim or anything, but, like, they're afraid. Like,
yeah,
they have a fear. And I know that's sort of how I feel about dogs. I don't like dogs. Like, I really don't like dogs. Animals like me and, like, dogs like me and stuff like that. So a dog would, like, run up to me and blah, 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 and I'd just be like, okay.
She don't like any animal. She's
yeah, and I almost feel like that's how I feel about the doctor. Like, when I go, I will go.
Yeah.
You know, and I'll go for a checkup every year, you know, go see the gynecologist every year like you're supposed to or whatever. But I hate going.
Yeah.
I hate, like, getting pap smears. I literally just be like, oh, my God, okay. Like, I just have to, like... I just have to like get through it. I have to like get through the visit. And it just seemed like something off about that. Like, it shouldn't be like meeting with your doctor, and especially like as a woman too. I mean, anybody, because I know like as Black people in general that have this type of aversion, but especially like as a woman, a part of me does feel like it shouldn't be meeting with your doctor, for especially for like your reproductive health, and especially if you get pregnant and stuff. It shouldn't be like something you have to like grit your teeth and like get through, right?
I've seen in like hospitals, you know, I'm just like working in hospital, I'm like, this is not right. Like, I would not do this if like I wouldn't do it if I was a doctor, you know. And there's this thing called it's like a coined word now, but it's called obstetrical rape.
What is that? I'm already paranoid. You can tell me about this stuff. I'm like, just like, tell me more so I can never go to the doctor again in my life. Thanks.
No, I'm just like making people aware that like
don't be aware.
But like obstetrical rape is like pretty much just like obstetricians and stuff just like pretty much not asking for permission to do things. So there's this thing called like pelvic or vaginal cervical exams, like vaginal exams during birth to see how many centimeters you're dilated.
Right.
You know, I've seen people just like not really ask and be like, I'm gonna do this now, and it's like very like you're putting their whole hand in you, you know, when they're doing it. And it's just like that's something that like you should be like honored that they even let you do that for
right.
the first like first off. And then there's this really good meme going around. I don't know who made it, but I can like send it to you. But you know, it says it's like pretty much how it's like to ask to do that,
right?
And the first one,
oh, this is like a hospital. This is like a doctor.
So the hospital,
a hospital meme, like a reproduction meme.
Yeah. So the first one, the first one is like what the hospitals usually say, like when you're ready, I'm gonna give you an exam,
right?
And it's just like, okay, that's not really asking for permission, right? And the second one is just like, let me know when you're like ready so I can do a pelvic exam. I don't know exactly what it is. But the last one is, do you feel comfortable with me giving you a pelvic exam when you're ready?
Mm-hmm.
Again, you got to kind of slow down and like really ask for permission.
Consent. Yeah, we're talking about consent.
Ask for permission to that part of your body.
I think that even plays into like larger conversations that we've been having right now about consent. I think a lot of people do not understand consent or what consent is.
Yeah.
Men and women, like a lot of people just don't understand about consent and like people's bodies and like getting permission to like touch people's bodies or like engage with people's bodies in a certain type of way.
Yeah.
I definitely think that that's
every time before I touch like my clients, I'm like, okay, I tell them what I'm gonna do. I'm telling them like, okay, so like I see you're having a lot of back labor, which is like they feel a lot of pain right here and like they're in their coccyx bone or whatever. Instead of like down here where they should, this means the baby is turned a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
It will probably turn in the right direction later on, but in the early birth, it can be really, really painful. So I'm like, oh, I see you're having a lot of back pain. Like, there's positions you can do. Like, do you feel comfortable with me touching you in that area?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, simple as that.
Mm-hmm.
Can like make a world of difference. Instead of just be like, okay, I'm gonna do this now. And
right.
just like, okay, wait.
Right.
You never know what could be triggering to people.
Right. Yeah. I also think that that's like even more, what's the word I want? I don't know. Fucking pronounced maybe for Black people and for Black Americans specifically, as you know, we're talking about descendants of American chattel slavery, because there's this idea that like we don't even have ownership of our own bodies, and that historically we have not had ownership of our own bodies, and Black American women specifically, you know, like we have not had, and Black American men as well, you know, we have not had ownership of our own bodies. And there's even still, I feel like, a lot of talking about even like intergenerational trauma and like trauma and the effects of trauma and history even being like in people's DNA and stuff like that. I even think you still have a lot of like white people, and the majority of the doctors, when you like go see the doctor and stuff, it'll probably be like a fucking white person that still even feel this like ownership. They still feel a lot of ownership over our bodies, and so I do think a lot of that can even like play into it as well, of them just like really not giving a fuck about like touching you in a certain type of way or like doing things, because there is still almost this like underlying, this like subconscious like idea of ownership. I mean, and even that can even be expanded of like strange, you know, strange white people like touching your hair and like touching you and like, you know, not moving out of the way, bumping you, and just like feeling all this like ownership over your body that they can fucking touch you, and you'd be like, don't fucking touch me, like don't touch me.
Yeah,
so I definitely feel,
I mean, I'm gonna be the worst when it comes to birth, like, or in this, yeah, especially when I have kids, it's like,
yeah, don't touch me.
I got this.
Yeah, don't touch my body. Don't touch my body.
Like, we've been doing this for years. Like, yeah. I'll let you know.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just like, I have ownership of my own body. We all, you know, we have ownership of our own bodies. And people just feeling really entitled. People feeling entitled to fucking Black American, like, bodies is a fucking thing. Mm-hmm. Like, that shit's trippy. I'd be like, how you just feel comfortable just like touching, like, don't,
oh man,
I don't really like being touched.
It was like the worst. I was at this party, it's gonna get a little deep, but I was at this party and like I was just like, everything was going well. I was like, because I'm a nanny right now, that's what I like do for a living, and I was like meeting this family, and the family was really nice, but like grandpa was like real creepy. I didn't think he was creepy at first, but then like I was like getting ready to leave, and I actually had this t-shirt on. This t-shirt's kind of like a midriff, and like I know, like, normally don't wear a bra, but thank god like I wore a bra that day. And like he just like totally like went in to like hug me,
went in for the hug,
and like just totally just like went inside my t-shirt and was just like, and like, what do I do? Do I like curse a little old grandpa? Like,
yes! Yes.
Like their whole family.
Yes.
So I'm trying to like get hired.
100% curse them out.
I like didn't know. I was like so like taking it back. I didn't even know what to do. I just like walked away. I just like,
wow.
But I felt like so just like violated.
Boundaries.
Just, like, yeah.
That was.
I'm just like, really?
Were they white? Was he white?
He's Indian.
Wow. I would have been like, what the fuck?
And just because
I would have
even
went
like
the fuck off.
Other people of color, like, don't even.
Well, I hate the phrase people of color personally. Yeah. I hate the phrase people of color, and I also sort of hate what the phrase people of color, the way that it is used, especially like nowadays, because it's used like as a synonym for Black.
Yeah.
People, and I have a whole theory.
I
feel like, number one, that's because people are uncomfortable saying Black,
mm-hmm.
because Black is seen as like a bad thing, is like a negative, you know, like internalized anti-Blackness as well as racism. People don't like saying Black. It makes people uncomfortable. When you say like, I'm Black.
What's your way?
You're Black.
Train.
When you say like, I'm Black, or like even like, I'm a Black American, I'm a descendant of American chattel slavery, that stuff comes with certain connotations that makes
totally.
People fucking uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And afraid. Then you have like this catch-all phrase of like, people of color, which is like a very nice sort of safe catch-all phrase that also lumps all these different types of people together. And I think it also absolves non-Black persons of color, especially, from the fact that they can also practice anti-Black racism, right? Like, non-Black people of color not only can practice anti-Black racism, most of them do actively practice anti-Black racism. They benefit from anti-Black racism. We've been talking a lot on the channel about this hierarchical structure within the system of racism, white supremacy, mm-hmm. where you sort of have white people at the top, and then you kind of have non-Black persons of color, and then you sort of have, you know, foreign Blacks, however you want to call that, and then you sort of have Native Blacks, Black Americans, descendants of American chattel slavery at the bottom. And so this term like POC, person of color, and the way that people use it as if it's synonymous with Black, it's like, yes, all Black people are persons of color, but all persons of color are not Black.
Right.
And you do have non-Black persons of color that are fucking racist against Black people.
Yeah,
and they will actively, you know, practice racism against you. And then when you say, hey, that's not cool, cool that that was racist, they'd be so taken aback, like, well, I'm a POC just like you. Like, no, don't do that. It's like a lot of gaslighting almost that happens around a lot of this language, and I don't like it at all. I don't even like being called a POC. Like, don't call me a POC, don't call me a person of color. Like, if you're talking to me, I'm black, you can call me black, I don't fucking care if that makes you uncomfortable. Because I've literally seen people say, like, I don't like calling people black, it makes me uncomfortable. Why does that make you uncomfortable? Like, are you a fucking racist? Like, why does it make you uncomfortable, you know? Like, call me black, or yes, please, like, take it one step further, call me a black American, call me a descendant of American chattel slavery.
I really don't like African American.
Everybody knows I hate being called African American. Like, don't call me that shit, please. Please don't. I feel like we need to be, like, way more deliberate with language.
Yeah.
Way more deliberate, because people are getting things very much conflated. And then even when you just, like, factor in, like, more things, like, for example, you know, Black Americans, DACS, we have, like, number one consumer power, right? Our consumer power is in the trillions because we fucking buy everything. So it's very nice to have a term like POC, because then when a movie like Crazy Rich Asians comes out, they could say, well, POC, we're all in this together. You guys should support our movie, right? Go out and watch our movie, because you guys have all this buying, purchasing, consumer power, right? But then when, like, the shoe is on the other foot and we say, well, hey, support this black thing, people don't want to support the black thing because they're fucking racist. You know, there's a lot of, like, using and abusing of black Americans, which I've also been talking a lot, even in terms of, like, the whole, like, foreign black thing of just, you know, we're all POC when it's convenient. We're all black when it's convenient. Right. But then when it comes time to support DACS black Americans and stuff, we're on our own, you know? And even getting back to what we were talking about in terms of, like, the reproductive aspect of it, like, so much of this, you know, the stuff about medical apartheid and the stuff that's kind of coming out of American racism stems from American chattel slavery. So how do we separate that? How do we separate that? You know, y'all want to be lumped in and get the and reap the benefits, but, like, y'all weren't on the operating table being cut up by J. Marion Sims. We were. And it's just like, we need to start having, like, way more, I feel like, realistic and honest conversations about this type of thing, because I think it does matter.
It legit makes people uncomfortable too, to have it. Which in itself is a sign that it's something that needs to be, like, delved.
Why is it making you uncomfortable? Why are you defensive?
Yeah.
Totally. So I did want to ask you too, was there, like, any, you talked about it, like, briefly, but was there, like, anything in particular? Was there, like, a specific incident? Maybe incident is not the right word, but was there anything in particular that made you want to, like, become a doula or get into, like, reproductive health or anything like that? Were you just, like, always curious about it? I don't know. Were you, like,
no, I've always been around
babies?
Yeah, I was definitely a kid that loved babies. I loved all my, like, little baby cousins and, like, I don't know. I'm always really close to my mom. Like, me and my mom are, like, best friends. And
do you have, like, siblings and stuff?
Yeah, I'm the youngest. Okay. Yeah, I'm the youngest. My parents are pretty, like, older too. So I'm, like, definitely, like, the baby. Like, my parents are in, like, their 60s and 70s, you know? And me being my 20s, I feel like that's always, like, made me, like, a little different in how I view the world than, like, some of my friends, people I grew up with.
Do people ever talk to you weird about it, or be like, you know, well, what do you mean you're, like, a doula, or what do you mean you encourage women not to have babies in hospitals, that's not safe? Or are people ever, like, weird about it? Yeah,
people are definitely like, what? Like, people definitely freaked out about having home births, which is really
right.
I'm more freaked out about having births in hospital.
Me too.
People are definitely like, and it's cheaper too, like,
to do it at home.
Midwives and stuff. You know, people have, like, big ass baby showers and stuff. You know, right? People spend tons of money on baby showers and gifts and stuff like that. Like, why not put all that money into, like, your own community? Because I'm pretty sure wherever you live, there is a black midwife somewhere, and, like, black doulas and stuff that would be willing to work. You just have to put in time and effort and research.
Right.
But
one of my closest friends in D.C. is a midwife. She's a midwife in a physician's assistant.
Yeah, and their range is usually around $3,000 to $6,000, mm-hmm. which is like,
I don't know how much it costs to have a baby. How much does it cost?
A lot of times people are covered by medical insurance and stuff like that. Leaving medical insurance is not covered. In some places you cannot do that, like California and like more progressive states have like, but there's like laws where like you cannot practice midwifery outside of a hospital. I don't know what states, so I never lived in them, I never looked it up, but I'm sure there's like,
so you are required by law to pay money to have a baby
in a hospital.
Capitalism. I just,
yeah,
every day,
but yeah, so usually like
capitalism a little bit more and more.
Yeah, so cesarean sections, you know, without a pocket, without medical insurance, usually some, you know, there's usually some government substitutes, subsidization and stuff like that, but usually if you're paying out of pocket, it's usually around like $20,000.
Fucking god, $20,000 to have a baby? Are you kidding?
Yeah, and then without
that just blew my mind.
Vaginal birth would be about like $13,000.
That's why my mother was one and done.
Yeah,
my mother probably still
paying. I think it was like low end. I'm just like guessing, but it's like in the, you know, higher, you know, around
$20,000. That's
obscene. Did you pay for the hospital bed? Yeah.
That's intense.
And then more and more, like, hospitals became, like, more and more, you know, corporate, you know. Sutter's buying everything. Kaiser's buying everything. So it's not even, like, individual, like, hospitals. That's another thing. If you're going to have hospital birth, I heard that, like, general hospitals are better.
Mm-hmm.
Like, more of, like, private hospitals are a little bit better. That's the one I work for. It's, like, a government hospital, federal. A lot of people on Medicare and stuff like that go, and they have like a little bit more assistance, but it's still a hospital. They still do stuff I'm just like,
no,
I wouldn't do if I was doing it.
Are you allowed to like speak up, or do you normally just, no, that sucks.
No, I stay in my lane, because I also don't want to say the wrong thing.
Right.
Like,
so do you sort of just like do whatever you can, do what you can.
Yeah, do what I can.
That's where it's at.
Yeah.
I guess.
Yeah. But made me really like, definitely made me realize like, I don't want to do like labor and delivery nursing. It's because.
Yeah, you said you wanted to go into nursing?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm thinking about ER nursing. I haven't gotten into nursing. I got into a school, but I haven't like
picked what you're gonna study yet.
Yeah,
exactly.
Once a clinical start, I probably know. But like, this ER just sounds like a little bit more right. I'm still like fucked up politics and that, but I don't know. I feel like if you're in the ER, like you need to be in the hospital.
Yeah.
You know, like,
that's so proactive though. Like, you wanted to help people, so you're like very actively helping people with their health. That's cool.
I just like,
I applaud you.
Thank you. I just wanted to be like one of those people that like, you know, people that look like me. I want to help them out.
Yeah.
And then, you know, like,
and people need help
as much as I can. Like, you know, I'm still going to be a part of this institution. You know, there's still things that I can't do. So I'm going to lose my job. Like, those dudes start doing things like, oh, the Adrian's doing that. Like, let's start, like, you know.
But your doula work is outside of the institution, or it's in?
Yeah, I still, you know, I keep my boundaries, but like, I can pretty much still, I still stay like, so, I'm not being paid, you know, I'm a volunteer.
Right.
And I do the hospital stuff, so like, I still say things. Like,
yeah.
But.
That's cool.
I'm always just like, the people are usually like, give me an epidural. I'm like, you sure? I'm like taking my time, like walking out the door, like asking them. And I'm like, but you're so close. I like try to trick them. Like, you're so close. Like, you're like 4 centimeters. Like, you just got to get to 8. Because once you get to 8, like, I'm just like talking to them. Like, you have to get to 8. Like, yeah, like 10 come because you want to be 10 centimeters. Like, but 10 is like around the corner. And just like, get to 8, get to 6. Like, you're so close. Like,
I'm so paranoid about epidurals because I know somebody that got one and they like did it too fast and they fucked up. And she was like paralyzed. She had to like, not like permanently, but she had to like, they like injected it, the shit into like one of her nerves.
Mm-hmm.
And she had to like do physical therapy for like months and like basically learn how to walk again. I mean, she stayed the fuck out of the hospital and got like a nice settlement.
Mm-hmm.
But still, I was
like,
why?
Like, I know that, you know, that's yes. a risk, but I never actually heard somebody actually.
Yeah, I know that. Somebody that it happened to. And then I right. said, like, my, and then my cousin who had a C-section, she got like a bacterial infection in her stomach from an infection that she picked up in the hospital that she had to have like the drainage bag. And then like, this was like a totally different hospital, totally different place. And like some other bad shit happened. And I'm just like, you see, if I have a baby, I'm definitely going to do it at home. Like, I'm paranoid. I was already
keep yourself healthy.
I was already paranoid, and now you just like moved me up to like level fucking 10 yeah. paranoia about fucking hospitals.
Keep yourself healthy so you don't have to like have high risk and stuff, you know. Because high risk, you know, people are like, what's high risk? You know, if you have high blood pressure, you know, any kind of heart thing, even if you're like, you know, like if you're 35 and having a baby, it's called geriatric birth.
Yes, I did know that. I did know that.
Like 35? Are you serious?
Yes, like, I did know that.
That's so young.
Yes.
That's so young. Everybody's body is so different, you know? That might be geriatric for one person, right. but it's not geriatric for everybody. Like,
so do you feel like the way, well, I'm probably going to say yes, but so do you just feel like overall the way that the medical system operates in general, but also especially in terms of like reproductive health, is like outdated with these like terms and concepts?
Oh, well, yeah, there's like a thing with midwives. Midwives are like, the doctors are like 20 years behind. You already know. Like, they'll be like, oh, you know, when we talk about like, oh, you need to eat during birth, you need to eat during birth. It's like common fucking sense. Cause like, the uterus is the strongest muscle in the human body.
Really?
Mm-hmm. It says like, when it's in contracting, that's a ton of pressure that is like pushing down on it. And a lot of times, like, oh man, I can go on and on about this. A lot of times, like, that pressure will like kind of like make the baby's heart drop a little bit, mm-hmm. heart rate drop, and that always freaks doctors out. And they'll be like, I've seen it before, like, you know, the woman would change position and like the baby will like drop all of a sudden, mm-hmm. and the heart rate will like go down. And then like, I've seen doctors just like, doctors and nurses just rush into, because they're monitoring. They're not even looking at you, what you're doing. They just see,
like, the male
monitoring, and they see a drop, and they're just like, they all just come in, like,
why is it a fucking
like,
machine?
They're like, get emergency C-section ready, like, right now. I've seen this happen. And then, like, that just, like, freaks the birthing person out. They're like, oh, like, is something wrong? And like, yeah, like,
it sounds very great. Stressful.
And it's just like, it's so stressful. It can be so stressful. And, yeah.
I just took a class in fucking birthing. Thank you. I know it's been like an hour, right? Do you know how long it's been? I don't really like to go too far over an hour.
Yeah.
I've been keeping an eye on the clock. 51 minutes. Yeah. Okay. Cool.
Yeah, well, I don't know if there's anything else we want to talk about besides birth. In the last 10 minutes. Last 5 minutes. I don't know.
Is there anything you want to talk about? Do you want to like tell like a good birthing story, or a bad birthing story, or a reproduction story? Or I mean,
my first birth I ever attended was beautiful, and it made me want to continue going. I think if I saw a bad birth, I would have been like, I don't
freak
know
out.
This. Yeah, it was really, really beautiful, which I think that was just like a sign in itself. And she wanted an epidural, but it was too late, and
So she just pushed it out.
And like, I remember just seeing the head that's like right there, and I was like, wow, it's happening. And like, I went to go visit her the next day while she was like breastfeeding and stuff, and she like, baby was latched on, her first time, and like, her husband was there, super supportive. There was nobody else around, just her and her husband and me, and the nurse was black, and she did a really, really, really good job.
I wanted to talk to you about that.
She was like, because the nurse is like, I gotta leave at 6, you know, like, let's try to get the baby out. And she's just like, what time are you leaving? She's like, 6. She's like, okay.
She's like, before six, let's do it.
Yeah, because who knows what doctor's gonna come in, right. Like, nurse is gonna come in, you know, that she doesn't know. So she's just like, she like looked at me, she's like, I trust you guys, you know? And like, I really, really feel like, you know, that made a difference, me looking like her.
Yeah. That was what I wanted to sort of talk to you about this, because you said you were a doula, and I thought that'd be really interesting to talk about, because I know a lot of people don't know very much about like doulas and midwifery and, you know, all that reproductive stuff.
Yeah.
And I do think it's important to have have, you know, doctors that look like us, doulas that look like us, midwives that look like us. You know, there have been all these studies that show, especially that white doctors, again, you know, they don't think we feel pain and they lack empathy towards us, and medical apartheid and experimentation, and taking something that, you know, should be a really, like, again, the cool, transformative, amazing personal experience of, you know, bringing life into the world and just making it really, you know, scary and stressful, and you're surrounded by these doctors and nurses that don't look like you and that possibly think you're not even feeling any pain, or they're like over medicating you, or, you know, all this stuff. And I do sort of think, when I imagine, like, you know, ideal, I guess, childbirth, I do think of, like, you know, a really kind of like calm, warm setting, like surrounded by people that look like
love,
me,
like, all the oxytocin is just flowing, you
yeah
know? That's the hormone that causes contractions and stuff, is oxytocin.
Oh, it's oxytocin. No, I didn't
and
know
that's
that.
The same thing that when you, like, look into your lover's eyes, that you feel like butterflies.
Yeah, I know, that's like love
is oxytocin. It's,
yeah.
So, like, all of that, and, like, I feel like,
and I even sometimes watch
very sexual experience too, and I feel like that's kind of like uncomfortable for people,
for people
to, like, admit. It's a very, like, it's the same area. It's a very, like,
it is reproduction, right?
Yeah.
I think, like, even I sometimes watch, this might sound weird, but I even sometimes, like, watch, like, old movies and stuff, and I mean, like, really, like, old movies, like, movies that are depicting, even, let's say, like, the 20s or something like that, and, you know, depicting a birth, a home birth amongst, like, women, black women, and it's just, like, a group of, like, black women that are, you know, supporting the woman that's giving birth and, like, helping her, like, bring this kid into the world, and versus sort of the way we do it now. And it does seem like a disconnect, and I did want to talk about, like, what did you personally think, you know, was best for black women? I thought you'd be, like, good to talk to you about it. So
thank you.
I'm glad
you.
That we were able to talk about it.
Me too. I love talking about it. This is my favorite topic.
Yeah. So I hope you have fun.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
So it's already been like an hour, so we can probably stop. We can probably wrap up.
Yeah.
That was cool.
Thank you for letting me talk about my passion.
Yeah.
So I can go,
I mean, you're an expert, so I thought it'd be dope to talk to you about that.
Yeah.
And I think that shit is cool, so I don't have children.
Yeah.
I would like to have kids,
it's just like fear in general, you know, around birth. It's just so much fear around birth. People are always like, birth is so scary. And it's just like, it's because we've been conditioned. Like, look at what it looks like on TV. Like, people are just like, literally, that's like the smallest part.
Oh, really?
That's the smallest part of birth. A lot of times people are just like,
It's very mysterious. It's all, like I said, even getting back to, like, talking about how we learned about reproduction, biology, and stuff in school, it's like very mysterious. It's like shrouded in all this mystery, like,
yeah.
What really happens? Who knows?
Who knows?
You won't know until you fucking go through it.
Yeah, and then you get blindsided, like, I can't do it, I need to reproduce.
Okay, so quick addendum that I wanted to talk about really quick. You mentioned being a black nurse and knowing that you're gonna have to deal with white people that don't want a black nurse. Tell me more about that. I want to hear about that. Have you had that happen? Has that happened?
No, I haven't had that happen, but I know other people who have had that happen. And this is stuff I'm gonna see, you know? Like, I'm probably gonna see doctors that aren't gonna try as hard. You know, to say I'm working in the ER, I could have probably tried as hard if it was like a young white girl, like, for instance.
Right.
You know,
so you said
trauma, then like a black, you know.
So I'm so
like,
stressed out on your behalf.
It's done anyway, so just like, you know.
That's like stress from like both sides. You're getting like, you have to be prepared to deal with like a white doctor that might not want to like fuck with you, and you also have to be prepared to work with like white patients that might not want
to
fuck with you because you're black. And other nurses. That's so stressful.
And I'm young, too. And I look young. So I already know that I gotta go in there with both guns blazing.
And that's not gonna be a part of, I highly doubt there's like a class in nursing school how to fucking deal as a black nurse. I'm stressed out for you.
But luckily I have other friends, you know, I have friends that are going to turn into. So, you know, I definitely wanna like once I get into it, like have like maybe it's like a group.
Yeah,
like
that's how
you meet up and like talk, you know.
So you have like a plan sort of to deal with it.
Yeah. My own plan that I wanna work with, like friends that I know, like, hey, just like putting your friends on a hike or something this weekend.
What, you said you've never had that happen to you, but you know somebody that has?
I know somebody, and my friend was just like, you're gonna go to nursing, like my friend goes, got in nursing, and like, she just get, I think she like, works in the South. I spent a friend went to the South, so she might like, get a little bit more. You know, say that, you know, I don't know. You're supposed to be like,
oh, progressive, so progressive, yeah.
Blah, blah, blah. And then you like really get out there in the real world and people are just as racist anywhere.
Right.
Damn. That's so much worse, and they try to cover it up. It's like, this is,
yeah.
Be real. Like, if you, that's what you are, then just be real.
You don't want a fucking nigger nurse, just go ahead and say it.
Right. Instead of just passive aggressive.
Do you feel like that deters a lot of black people from getting into nursing or getting into
science in general? Science in general. Yeah. When I did environmental science for my first degree, I tried to get into breaking science. You have to do a lot of field work outside. You know, not a lot of us are out there doing camping.
So would you give, just from the experience that you've had, like as a doula thus far and working in the sciences thus far, would you, what type of advice would you give to a person that wants to get into that? If any, you don't have to, just ask me. I'm curious.
Yeah.
It's really interesting to me that you said that, because I didn't even think about it, but like, yeah, duh, obviously.
You gotta get a support. You gotta get your own support group outside of whatever you're doing. Whether it's your family, your friends, you know, other people. You gotta get a support group. And then you like truly, truly have to love yourself too. At the end of the day, that's all you have. You gotta love yourself and know that like you are capable, no matter what society says that you are capable, that you are great, you are magical, whatever you gotta say, but like build yourself up, it's true. You know, like, we survived a lot of shit. We can survive somebody being like, oh, I don't wanna work with you. Fine. You know, like,
fine then.
Yeah.
As you bleed out on the table.
Yeah.
See, that's why I couldn't be a nurse, because I'd be petty. I'd be a petty nurse.
Yeah, they color.
I'd be like, fine, I don't want to work with you. Just so you know, you have a fucking, you just ripped your whole vagina pushing out that baby. But you don't want me to fucking sew you up? Fine. Bye. And then they'd be like, ma'am, can you leave? That's why you can't deliver people's babies. That's why I wouldn't be a nurse. All right.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. Awesome. Okay. Perfect.